make the screen go blank. I realize it's not quite time to start. Are you recording back there, right? Microphone people, are you available? Yeah, between the debate last night and my talk this morning, I will have given a substantial amount of information. As you can see, I have a substantial amount of information more we could do. But what I've usually found is the Q&A, because we have so much to talk about 10 minutes, I want to make sure we have Q&A after this talk. But I also, if there were questions lingering from last night about approach or things I said, or questions from this morning, I wanted to make sure that maybe we did two or three questions before I gave new information. I mean, it's always possible that the questions will be so invigorating, we'll never get to new information. We're kind of booming, so let me make sure. So here's a question, and there are questions everywhere. So my intuition was a correct one. Yes, sir.
In the last session, you were talking about beauty.
Yes.
And you started off mentioning that the comparison of gilding the roof, beauty,
yeah,
and the utility of giving to missions.
Yeah.
How is giving to missions not beautiful?
I suppose everything human beings do is beautiful, and you can give to missions beautifully. I think one mistake that people made, let me say something as a person from Appalachia, a place where people go to do short-term missions. Very often what the colleges would do is come and build things for us or dig ditches. Capacity we actually had. It never occurred to anyone to come and contribute culturally to my small town. I don't know whether they thought it would be condescending or something like that, but nobody ever brought us art and culture from a Christian college. They came and did things that probably we were capable of doing ourselves. And then wrote papers, learned papers, where I would discover that people I made friends with over the summer viewed me as a socioeconomically deprived child. It's always bad when little kids can read and discover that they were the target of charity. So sometimes our missions isn't beautiful to the extent that we do it in a kind of, this is what I'm doing, and it's sort of an ugly act. But of course, missions could be done beautifully. I don't want to set the two in total opposition, but you'll notice if I ever go to a church where someone says, we can't give to missions because we're making the nursery beautiful, then that would be an interesting discussion. We'd have to say, okay, are we gilding the piano? Have we gone too far and we don't have a value for missions? But I have actually never heard that argument expressed out loud. Maybe someone's bold enough to say, we're making our church more beautiful, so we should give nothing to missions. But I've never heard that expressed. What I hear a lot in Christian higher education is, we can't afford to round the corners of this library building because that would cost too much money and be a waste of God's money, even though it would make the building more beautiful for the next 50, 60 years that we plan on using it. Now, maybe you sit in different, I'm not kidding, I'm not being sarcastic. You may sit in different meetings where self-indulgent people, certain evangelists believe that God wants them to have a super expensive jet, right? Or they can't do ministry. Somewhere between that and what I'm talking about is a middle ground, right? When people are just being greedy, and it's hard to know, right? When are people just being greedy? In the real world, that's a hard call. But I have to say, in my personal life, maybe it's because I had an excellent father and I went to excellent churches that had excellent values towards missions and loving the poor, we were always scrimping on beauty to help other people. And sometimes doing an ugly job of it, right? Not providing the people we were helping with beauty along with what we were doing. Put this way, Hope and I once were very broke and were very grateful for the fact that our church helped us from the food pantry, but it was really rare for people to give us a delicious meal that was tasty. They rightly, because we were broke, focused on, pinto beans. I'm from West Virginia, eat those four times a week, and that's every dinner. That's great, and you can eat them for lunch cold. But, maybe once It would have been nice if somebody had sent us something they would have wanted to eat for dinner, you know, beautifully made, that sort of thing. I know that a lot of churches do that. When my grandmother passed away, her home church brought beautiful meals, right, every night, and they were served well. And people took their time to do that, and I think that was an important part of the charity, you know, presenting well the meal. So the two don't have to be in conflict, obviously. Judas set them up in conflict, right, not John Mark. If this woman breaks the alabaster and pours it over the Lord's feet, wouldn't it have been better to take that money and sell it, you know, take that object, sell it, and give the money to the poor instead of the performance art she was involved in? I think we might have compromised in our church by picking cheap perfume. Right? We'd have said, okay, we get the symbolism, so we have to do this. We have to have a Christmas pageant, but we don't want to spend too much money on our Christmas pageant, so let's just do it this way instead of that way. And I'll only say as far as I can tell, Judas is the only person to make that argument, and the Lord rebuked him and said, what this woman did will be repeated in her memory wherever the gospel is told. So it's hard, right? The middle ground is hard to find. And it's relatively, you have to know people's motives, right? It would come down to your motive. I wish I could give you a definitive answer in the always spend money on beauty. Never spend money on missions. But then it's a Baptist room. You would either be a mob and people would come. It's like Frankenstein. You would trap me in a burning windmill. Any other questions?
Talk about beauty this morning and women not seeing their beauty. I have a wife and two daughters.
Right.
And raising them up. But my wife, she struggled with eating disorder in high school.
Right.
And it doesn't matter what I say, I feel.
Right.
She doesn't see her beauty.
Right.
What are some practical things that I can do to help her?
Well, I have had relatives, I won't go into too much detail because, of course, you know, we're on tape. I've had relatives that have had to spend extended periods of time in the hospital because of this problem. So let's start by saying, once this sort of problem develops, you know, it needs medical treatment, it needs sometimes years of counseling to get better. So there's nothing that you and I can do to short circuit that process, sadly. I think what we can do to contribute, so let me give you four suggestions to contribute and then to help your daughters, is first of all, the amount of media we consume, and I mean all media, that would include anything with images in it, should be controlled, and as much as possible, try to make the images of women and girls you're seeing varied. You know, if in your family you only watch superhero movies, the images of men and women are all going to fall between the ages of, 20 and 32, however old Hugh Jackman is. He seems to be able to keep playing superheroes forever. It's all going to fall in that range, and it's all going to be a particular look about humans. And so even though there might not be anything wrong with the film per se, if that's mostly what everybody consumes, you're getting a really strange image of what human beings should look like. And notice that's not worldview. That's not a message you can sit and talk to people about. That's just the total amount of imagery that you're pursuing. The other thing is to sit down and take a look. There are lots of websites now that do before and after shots with Photoshop. And just sit and show everybody what it's like. Look, this is what this person looks like without makeup, male or female, right? This is not, human beings don't look like this. They look like this. This is what people look like before and after Photoshop. And there are lots of websites that do that. Now, again, you know, somebody who has gotten to the point where they have an eating disorder, this isn't going to make it better in the sense of it's going to go away, but it can help everybody see the truth of it. And so sometimes when we have a problem that's emotional, that goes beyond intellectual, we're not going to solve an emotional problem with intellectual solutions, but it does help to know it's a lie, the thing we believe about ourselves. And then, of course, we just keep reinforcing it. I mean, I'm not talking about you personally, but at least amongst my college students at Biola, the one time we could get data, essentially all the men we dealt with looked at porn. And I forget what the stats are for pastors, so I don't want to quote them directly, but lots of pastors struggle with looking at porn. And nothing is more debilitating to your spouse than to discover that you yourself, when you're voluntarily choosing to look at images of beauty, quote unquote, have chosen poorly. So avoid that. And of course, since I assume you're avoiding it because it's a sin, then think about, do we watch TV that's oriented towards our age? So 28 to 35, how old are you? 35. Yeah, okay, I'm a pretty good guesser. You know, make sure that you watch a lot of TV that's actually oriented towards people your age, and that can be really hard to do at 53, I can assure you, because no TV is made for people our age, essentially. But try to find some of that so that you have attractive role models. I mean, imagine being 53, my age, and looking for people in love who are in their 50s. You can't watch The Notebook that many times, despite what my wife claims. So, yeah, last question, and then we'll get into some new content. Yes, sir.
This question comes from the dialogue last night.
I thought
some of your arguments were interesting, and it's kind of an open-ended question, but do you think that we choose God because it's reasonable, or that God shows us reason, or how do you see that working together?
So do we choose God because it's reasonable, or does God choose us? I don't want to get into the doctrine of this, the theology of this, but I want to say a general truth. And then if you want to follow up, just shout out your question, because I don't want to have failed to answer your question. I believe that we can ascertain that God exists through reason. And I think as far as it can go, we can determine that Jesus lived, that the gospel accounts are generally historically reliable, and that suggests to us that Jesus might be the Son of God. However, I also think that just as it's different to hear about my wife than to see her, we do have an experience of God where we call out to God. This isn't irrational, right? It's not irrational when I think about hope and then I see her face to face and have an experience with hope. That adds to my data. I think sometimes as apologists, we're so concerned that people not merely rely on their religious experience that we forget that after all, it's important to have one. And that that's an important bit of data towards the truth of our claims. After all, given that all of us believe you must be what? Born again. If you couldn't be born again, if you cried out to God and nothing occurred, right? There was just no sense of being born again or no sense that God was there. That would, on the whole, count against the truth of what we believe. Now, it doesn't guarantee we're right. I get all of that, right? I'm a philosopher and an apologist. So I think we can intellectually reach certain points, but then we seek God. Now, depending on your theology, he either chooses those whom he will reveal himself to, or he reveals himself to anyone who calls out to him. This would be my own view. Let me not hide from that. And then we see God, and it gives us a certain experiential knowledge that because the person we met seems so good, true, and beautiful, the experience, as Thomas would say, St. Thomas would say, may be so great that it's hard to doubt it. It's sort of self-guaranteed. Now, not everyone has that kind of experience. And so even if you do have that kind of experience, you start to check on it intellectually to make sure that you're not crazy, that you've seen something correctly, that you haven't had a delusion. After all, there are people that have a delusion that something is true, and they choose not to live inside it. Because when they check on it, compared to the real world or to intellectual arguments, or if they're Christians to the Bible, their religious experience seems to them like it might be demonic. I have no reason, for example, to doubt that Joseph Smith had an important experience in Palmyra, near where I went to university, the University of Rochester, and then it motivated his life in some important ways. The question isn't whether he had a religious experience, it is what was behind it. Did he interpret it correctly? Was it God or devils or something in between? And we'd have to ask all sorts of questions. Sometimes people assume that just because I think religious experiences are real and that internally they can be so powerful they're hard to doubt, that we shouldn't begin the process of investigating them rationally. No, we're just going to have to. We can't trust ourselves that much. We could be crazy. Now, as much as it may seem like I'm crazy, I actually don't think there's any good reason to think I am, or that every religious person who has this kind of intense religious experience is just having, you know, a delusion or something like that. It seems like those are real things, that they occur in unpredictable ways. I mean, you might be able to study the brain chemistry of them while they're occurring. You might even be able to simulate them through particular drugs. After all, we can simulate all kinds of things using drugs now, right? It's not, take enough LSD and you can have all kinds of weirdo experiences. Now imagine having an insightful experience without taking a drug. And so I think it's a mixed bag, right? Our experience helps undergird the truth of the faith, but the truth of the faith also includes, think about the discussion last night, propositions. And when it comes to propositions, I assert, then faith, what I mean by faith, amounts to what, you know, Professor Shermer would describe as trust, based on a reason, you know, having reasons for it. Experience is hard to measure that way, right? Because we're trapped inside our own heads. And that's where I think skepticism actually serves us in good stead. Okay, let's have at some new material. We're going to do something a little bit different, and that is apologetics per se is often the defense of the Christian faith. But I also want to say, as apologists or as working philosophers, we also should do the job of trying to look at culture and not making predictions like the stock market, but trying to say, this is what goes poorly for culture, here's what goes well, here's where we might be headed, and here's what that means. Knowing the times, like the men of Issachar in the Bible. Is that a clear thing? You know, look at history, use our apologetics filter, use our worldview filters, and try to make reasonable future. This is what the immediate future looks like. This is not being a prophet. This has nothing to do with biblical prophecy or your views of Revelation. If you're a theologian, you might be able to talk about that, but I'm a philosopher. And I'm a philosopher who looks, does the history of philosophy in particular. Remember, my degree is in ancient philosophy. And I look at the world, I see some patterns, and we try to make judicious guesses about what might occur. Now, we hold those lightly, but notice that can help our churches make good decisions. Let me give you an example of my being very stupid about this and my being so-called insightful. If you go back about 9 years ago to Biola Open Source, a much younger, thinner me is giving a talk on the culture of celebrity. And I point out that more and more being famous is a matter of celebrity, pure celebrity, and not a matter of accomplishment. So in my grandparents' generation, how did you get to be famous? You won the Second World War. You did something big, and that made you very famous, and people like my grandparents or great-grandparents would hang Dwight Eisenhower's picture up on the wall. Or if you came from a Catholic family, you might have grown up with John F. Kennedy's picture up on the wall, because at least allegedly he wrote a book. He was, you know, served in the Second World War, was a senator. Celebrity kind of was tied to accomplishment. We liked experts. Scientists, like the person who helped cure polio, were famous and really relatively well known. Movie stars, on the other hand, tended to be looked down on to the point that Ronald Reagan had to spend a lot of time fighting a prejudice against movie stars being taken seriously at all. A culture of celebrity began to replace a culture of accomplishment. Doesn't matter whether it's good or bad, it just was occurring. And so about 9 years ago, in looking at the culture, I said this. Donald Trump is thinking about running for president. He was, in fact, I guess 5 years ago, to put this tape, I guess it wasn't nine, it was 5 years ago, in context. And everyone in the room broke out into laughter. And you can go check the tape. And I say, no, you shouldn't laugh. Because in a culture of celebrity, Donald Trump has boatloads of the one thing that people are going to value the most. That is almost pure name recognition, the belief that people know him. You know, they've kind of grown up with Donald Trump around being ubiquitous, so nothing that happens to him is going to shock them. There's no dirt to deal on Donald Trump because he'll be judged by the culture of celebrity, not the culture of accomplishment. And the culture of celebrity says being famous, even for bad things, is being famous. Now, this isn't a political statement. Donald Trump may be awesome and you should have voted for him for president. It's just to say 5 years ago, it was clear that something like the Trump candidacy should be taken seriously, looking at cultural trends. However, this didn't help me at all as a practical person. I didn't see how someone like Trump could actually win. So notice the limits. Why am I saying this? One, to diffuse the notion that I'm some kind of prophet and can see the future through a crystal ball. In a way, the general claim about Trump was lucky. The claim about celebrity and knowing that I would have to take his candidacy seriously was not lucky. That he would be elected president, and go talk to a political person to see if they could see that coming. But that he could plausibly run for president, I always believed, because of a shift in the culture. Now, if you, as apologists, skilled in worldview, don't do this for your church, where you can help step back and say, here are the things that are controlling us, here are the way cultures go, who else will do it? So I'm going to suggest to you, this is a depressing talk. Are you guys ready? Like, we're all doomed kind of talk. Happy news. Apocalypse almost never comes to a culture. But it comes to a culture exactly when everybody gets really content with people like I am saying apocalypse almost never comes to a culture. There are two groups of people in most churches, at least as a pastor's kid when I grew up. There were sort of church ladies who believed that if you move the organ from the left side to the right side, sin would break out everywhere. Like any, it really did happen to my dad. So just imminent peril to the entire civilization from any change. And then you always have sort of the hipster youth pastor types who believe that change is awesome. A healthy church leaves the church ladies having a giant war with the hipster youth pastors while the rest of us muddle through the middle. Because plainly, like you should just keep them in a room, like they should meet on a committee, deadlock so that the church doesn't die. How many of you know change has to happen? Yeah, it has to happen. Now, what should change and what shouldn't change? What's negotiable and what's not negotiable? Some of that's decided by theologians. Some of that will be decided by you as people who look at worldview. But generally speaking, we need to keep a tension between good kind of conservatives who are like anchors in the church. Sometimes anchors are good. Hey, don't go that way. Or at least go that way more slowly. Versus change people. Now, here's my first suggestion. We have made it so that almost no one wants to be a church lady. Almost no one in the church wants to be an anchor. Now, if you're in a church filled with anchors, you're really mad at me right now. I just, generally in American culture, saying, huh, yeah, I know we're changing, but maybe this is a bad change, is not celebrated in popular culture. Can we sort of generally agree with that? Whereas the rogue is almost entirely celebrated. My dad used to say, look, John Mark, if you ever get lost as a little boy, this is pre-cell phones, find the local Baptist church, we are Baptist, this is really true, and knock on the door because they will have a deacon's fund and make sure you get home. And you know what? That's generally true. It is also remotely the case that you're in some horrible horror movie and you've run into the one evil, like cult-like Baptist church and you're never seen again. I watched too much science fiction when I was a kid. I also have done enough street ministry, not a lot, but enough when I was in college, to know that most people who live on the streets or work on the streets are deeply hurting, confused, drug-addled people that you wouldn't want to care for your children. I'm not trying to be funny. I'm just saying that's generally true. Notice in Hollywood films, we have made so much of the trope of the prostitute with a heart of gold that if I see a film with a Baptist minister, I assume he's an axe murderer, and I'd rather leave my children in the care of the local drug dealer who's probably got strong family values through his, I don't know, Italian family background, to pick on Hollywood tropes. Put another way, we've told the story of Jesus, of the Good Samaritan, so many times that sometimes I think we should tell the story of the Good Samaritan where the Samaritan is the Baptist preacher. And the people who pass by are the overt sinners of the society. Does this make sense? A lot of Jesus' talk only works if you assume that good people are generally good. And he's reminding you, look, sometimes that's superficial. And bad people are generally, but sometimes that's superficial. And so, surprise, it can be the other way around. Notice if you go too far with that. And so here's my first suggestion. We have demonized, culturally, anchor people and celebrated rogues. Folks, if you meet Han Solo, who's a drug runner who doesn't understand that parsecs isn't a measure of time or distance, it's just very confused about how he talks about it, who abuses all the people in his life, don't marry him. He's generally not going to turn out well. It's a wonderful shot. We no longer recognize this in the first Indiana Jones film, where Indy comes to see Marion in the Nepalese bar. And there's a giant shadow of Indy over Marion, because Indy is no good. And he is eventually redeemed. It was a standalone movie. The problem with the second movie is it doesn't take into account, and the third in particular, which is afterwards, any of this. He's not a good man. He's hurt her deeply. And yet somehow Hollywood, well, it'll be okay. And sometimes I suppose it is okay. The rogue is a lovable rogue. But ladies, what are rogues usually? Roguish rogues. Should you, on the whole, try to turn a rogue into Indiana Jones? No. And we've so forgotten that we like rogues better than Superman, so that we find it really hard to root for a character without flaws, to the point that when they made The Lord of the Rings, they had to introduce teenage angst into Aragorn, son of Arathorn, lest we all dislike him. We would follow Lancelot, not Arthur. So first point, when a culture is in trouble, either it becomes utterly opposed to change agents, not our problem, or it decides in a weird thing that good people are usually not good. All good people are hypocrites at their heart. When a culture isn't going to muddle through, it tends to follow the pattern of Russia about 1913. So I'm going to pick on Russia in about 1913. Russia should have muddled through. The Romanovs had ruled Russia for about 300 years. They had a constitution, the Constitution of 1905, that was forced from the Tsar by a revolution. Under that constitution, the Tsar had less power than Vlad Putin exercises in Russia today. The Duma, while it started off as fairly powerless, had become a relevant and important part of government that the Tsar could not ignore. He was a heavy smoker, like all the members of the family, who's, of course, more related to the English royal family than anyone else. He almost surely would have been dead of cancer within 8 or 9 years of 1913, a decade. His son had hemophilia. Given the medicine of the time, wouldn't have lived past his 20s at the best, which would have made the liberal in the good sense of the term, Michael, almost surely a constitutional monarch of a Russia that muddled through its Industrial Revolution. Remind yourself that the economy was growing faster than the Russian economy has ever grown since, that literacy was spreading at a rate that would have made all Russians literate, that Russian serfs, for example, so-called serfs, the Russians freed the serfs before we freed the slaves in the United States, Russian serfs ate better than German peasants, that there was a widespread increase in prosperity. If you had made a bet on Russia in 1913, you would have bet that it would muddle through, that the anchor people like the Tsar and the change agents, like the revolutionaries, would check themselves and Russia would go through the middle and survive. It did not. And the failure to survive killed at least 65 million people. What I'm urging on you today is to try to avoid the things in your church or your personal lives or to the extent you can in the culture that will prevent the culture from muddling through. And the first thing you want to do is avoid leadership that still believes in the old ways, is resistant to change, and out of touch with what's going on. I'll give you an example from Christian colleges. There's more than one Christian college I go to where the administration is enormously to the right, theologically, of the actual faculty that teaches in the school. And there's a really careful don't ask, don't tell policy between the two groups, where the avuncular leadership can go on and on, believing it's doing one thing while the faculty does something else, and the two groups don't even dislike each other. It's not a war. And this can work. It's not a good situation because there's a degree of falsehood in it, but I want you to notice how fragile it is. The Apostle Paul, in fact, was the master of rhetorically blowing up this kind of situation. You have the Sanhedrin. What are they united in doing? Let's kill Paul. Rhetorically, what does Paul manage to do? Divide the united by saying what? I'm on trial for... And because they had papered over a deep division, explosive split was always possible. Notice that if in your church or school or anywhere else in a country, God help us, if you have a leadership class that thinks they're doing one thing and everybody else is doing something else and we all agree to just sort of play the game, You have set up a position where somebody like Paul can blow up the entire situation by doing what? Telling the truth. By the way, that's the way to understand Mars Hill, Acts 17. Take a look at my book, When Athens Met Jerusalem. When Paul gets up and says, you worship a lot of idols, he's talking to people that we know, Luke lists them, the Stoics and the Epicureans, who don't worship idols at all. Paul's going to quote a Stoic, so we know he understood Stoic philosophy. What in the world is he doing accusing people opposed to idol worship of worshiping idols? Paul is blowing up the post-Socrates compromise in Athenian society, where philosophers will shut up about their failure to believe in Homeric religion, while Delphi and the Homeric religion keeps getting the regular people to sacrifice to idols, keeps the, you know, cards and money coming. And they call what they believe God is Zeus, or the pursuit of wisdom, Athena. We'll have an intellectual version of the Homeric religion up here, and then there's what the folks believed. It's the 1950s Episcopal Church, where the priest will get up and talk about the Jesus event while grandma thinks Jesus physically rose from the dead and puts money in the collection plate. You want to blow that church up? Get up and say, did Jesus physically rise from the dead in front of the priest? He's stuck. If he says yes, his colleagues will mock him. If he says no, grandma will stop giving money. Look at what Paul did to those poor Athenians. I bring you the real God. They all were monotheists in a sense. Wisdom undergirding the universe. God for the Stoics. The Epicureans, functionally atheists. God, like a deist, God's way off there, so they didn't get accused of atheism. When Paul said that, they could either say, no, we believe in the regular gods, or yes, we know that. We've been down that road and exposed the fraud. This is a very dangerous situation. Now imagine it inverted, where the regular folks still believe in the constitutional regime, but the leadership doesn't. Same problem. That's the Episcopal Church problem. Russia just ran the other way. Second, you develop an intellectual class whose main unifying feature is disliking the place they live. Whether on the right or the left, they spend most of their time being unhappy. I'm not talking about intellectuals being cheerleaders for any particular social order, but after all, we as academics have good lives compared to lots of people. And in most healthy societies, there's a balance between criticism of the society or the church. If you're in a church, think about the intellectuals in your church. When the intellectuals in your church become whiny, sad, negative, I hate Southern Baptists, oh, but they stay, like, infinitely. Just go. Rachel Held Evans, just become an Episcopalian. You'll lower the age of your parish by like 20 years when you join. When the intellectuals become wholly negative, and again, I don't care if you're conservative, like everywhere you look, you see sin and deprivation and you should blow the whole thing up. Or you're on the left and all you see is corruption and nobody loves anybody. You're just always wanging away about how bad things are. A culture will tend not to muddle through. The third thing that happens is religion, while it exists, becomes more and more nominal. Religious faith becomes a matter of affiliation more than it becomes a matter of belief. Conferences like this are, of course, at war with that very status. What are we saying? The Bible is true, not just awesome. Not hooray for the Bible. In a culture, it might be this. Hooray for the flag, but we wouldn't die for it. The the reaction to this is generally, in a culture, the rise of a cult or an irrational religion of power, where winning and power are the chief ways of measuring success. And yet, Christianity has as its central symbol a, which is at least in the short term, a symbol of losing. We are a religion of power and a religion of weakness. Take up your cross daily and follow me, says the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. The general reaction to the failure of the religious establishment is irrational religiosity, an increase in fideism. Why do you believe that? I just believe it. If you want to see an example of this, go into any internet political discussion with people who are all blue all the time or all red all the time. And you will see a total incapacity to see outside of a fideistic political bubble. If that grows, where irrational power, in this case Rasputin, tricks of a religious sort or tricks of a political sort becomes dominant, cultures tend not to muddle through. Now, depending on your politics, you either want to call this kind of person a conservative progressive or a progressive conservative, and I don't really care. This is when in your church, the person in the middle who says, yeah, we really should listen to the church ladies. There's something to be said for traditional worship. Let's listen to that. And somebody else who says, no, we've got to change. You know, the medium has changed. We've got to reach out to other people. The progressive conservative tends to say, wow, I see value in both sides, and try to bring those two things together. In a healthy church, in a healthy school, these are the people who govern. While the change agents push change, and the anchor people keep the change from becoming too rapid. The death of progressive conservatism, where it becomes moderate, where prudence becomes an insult. Churches, of all things, have ended up with youth groups where you're told, let's be radical for Jesus. Why in the world would we want to be radical for Jesus? Isn't excess or defect often a vice? Has anybody met someone who's too religious? My great-grandfather called them the person who was so straight they leaned a little. Right? Even the book of Esther, how many times is God mentioned in the book of Esther? Zero. There are a lot of churches where Esther would be kicked out of the church. You can become excessive. And whipping up excess is just as bad as putting people to sleep in defect. And I've been to those churches too that are so dry, if you struck a match, they'd burn to the ground. Right? So the progressive conservative says, the zeal for the house of the Lord has consumed me, but don't lose your head. Let's think hard and do good theology. Let's go change the world for Jesus. Which one is true? Both, and they stand in tension with each other, this side of paradise. Let's make things better. Yeah, but we're never going to make utopia. Which is true? Both. Notice if the church becomes too full of, yeah, no matter what we do, it's not going to be great. That's horrible. If the church becomes full of utopian idealists, that way often lies tyranny and madness and cults. Which is better? No. When asked to choose between the lesser of two evils, Christians say no. What is progressive conservatism? It is Disneyland. No. It is sort of like Disneyland. I love this shot of Disneyland. I actually took it myself, which is why it's so terrible, because Walt understood something. He has a picture of, he has the Matterhorn done to scale, very old-fashioned. You go there, a little Swiss music playing. Anybody been to Disneyland or Disney World, right? In fact, I took students from California to Switzerland. We saw the actual Matterhorn, and they said, oh, it's like Disneyland. This was a little sad. But notice the monorail, which when he built it was sort of a vision of the future, runs in front of it. And right underneath of it is Main Street USA, a kind of idealized version of Walt's childhood. It's an attempt to look forward while holding on to the best of the past. Now, Walt wasn't perfect, but do you see that? Oh, yes, the future is going to be great. I love science. I love what science is going to do. But, hey, we don't want to lose these old values. That's progressive conservatism or conservative progressivism. And that's how cultures muddle through. Now, the problem with all of this is notice who gets upset with this kind of thing. Somebody's going to ask a question and ask ideologically how to be perfectly consistent in our school, church, or government politics. But what does Aristotle teach us? Politics is the art of compromise, this side of paradise, not the result of ideology. Even King David wasn't that great as a ruler. True? We do the best we can. And any answer we apply to church governance is always going to be the best we can do as we learn and grow. But notice, there are worse things than doing the best we can do, which is the failure to muddle through by recognizing the tension. Here's good news. Generally, you'll still muddle through, even if you have all of these problems, unless the regime faces external pressure at the same time. It faces an existential threat like the First World War while it's undergoing all these internal inconsistencies. When this occurs, the middle disappears and becomes the left. It's Kerensky. You develop a group of radical intellectuals. These could be conservatives, by the way, as well as liberals. See Germany. Who develop radical utopian schemes, and young adults decide nothing could be worse than this. Now, again, forget countries and apply it to schools and churches. You get into a situation where the faculty or a group of people say, burn it all down, nothing could be worse than our current situation. This is almost never true in the history of ideas. Who dies? Always the innocent. By way of contrast, England went through a very similar period of time under Queen Victoria. In contrast to Russia, England, I think partly because of the Protestant Reformation, developed a progressive conservative tendency. This is Disraeli, who was a Tory, who wrote novels, Sybil, talking about how to help the poor and transformed conservatives in Britain from just landed gentry to people who were relevant to the industrial age. I could have also put up Gladstone, who would go out and work with prostitutes at night to try to help them come to his vibrant evangelical faith. The two of them really were just flip sides of the same coin. Progressive conservatives or conservative progressives. As Anthony Trollope would have put it, the great conservative novelist as popular in his day as Charles Dickens, who was also a progressive conservative, just more progressive than Trollope, it is the job of a Christian gentleman to kill the things he loves that cannot be saved because we'll save what can be saved. When change has to occur, the people who should bring the change about, if a church or a school or a culture is to survive, should be the people who love the old ways because they will save everything that can be saved and not destroy what shouldn't be destroyed. Which is why, unlike Russia, you can go through England and find much of the beauty of the old landed gentry, their houses, think Downton Abbey, or the fields or the hedgerows preserved, even though the old landed gentry has for the most part disappeared. Britain survived great internal pressure with people like Darwin attacking some of the basic Christian beliefs of the nation, and it survived great external pressure, the First World War, but it was a very near thing. Britain itself feared a horrific communist revolution, but its progressive conservatism, its tension, its failure to become ideological and find all of its solutions in one thing or another helped it muddle through. Now, the problem with muddling through is it's not very romantic. No one writes Les Miserables and music about muddling through. We will stand here reading Trollope, what hunting foxes and all day. You know, it's just not as exciting as barricades on the street unless you're living through barricades on the street. Barricades on the street are romantic until they're shooting you. Here's my suggestion. The United States, but particularly evangelical subculture, which I love and am a proud member of, shows many of the signs of an inability to change while conserving the best of the past. We're becoming more insular, more ideological, less able to listen to people that disagree with us. Agents of change are, what is it, the old phrase, immanentizing the eschaton. Anchor people are glorifying a mythical past in American history that didn't exist. If you think there is a wonderful past, let me make this point. Wonderful picture of my mother at age 16. She has an innocent look that in the culture of pornography in which we live would be impossible for a 16-year-old to have. Unless they grew up in a very sheltered home, and that has its own distorting effect. She's mainstream, yet innocent. And we look at that and we think, wow, if we could only go back to that. But she's sitting in a picnic pavilion with a sign that says, whites only. There is no golden age. Only muddling through. And that's true of our schools. If I were to examine the politics of this school, I don't know this, I would discover the seeds of imminent doom and the seeds of revival. What will likely happen if the school is healthy? You'll muddle through. It's actually people who just want revival often miss it because in seeking change, rapid change, the move of the Holy Spirit, they get ahead of the Holy Spirit and destroy revival. I was in a church that was in the middle of a huge revival. Drug addicts were driving down the street. My dad would be preaching on Sunday night. Drug addicts would stop outside the church. They would come in. They would get saved and flush all their drugs down the toilet. There was an older member of our church who would get up periodically, and he's a great man, tears streaming down his face, and say, why no revival in the church? Because his image of revival was the Welsh revival that he had studied so carefully. So revival was occurring all around him, and what did he do? He missed it. He went to another church. The best we can hope for this side of paradise as human beings is to muddle through. And my warning to you is that we have many of the signs of a nation no longer capable of doing that thing. The greatest danger currently is a Christian paganism that will confuse a will to power for Christian values with Christianity. I'll take questions if there are any. As they say, I've taken to meddling now. 10 minutes, I think. 5. Very quiet. Either what I said made no sense whatsoever.
Could you explain that last comment you made about confusing a will to power with the Christian?
Yeah, concept? I've written a piece on my blog, Eidos. If you type in Christian paganism, you'll come up with a piece on Christian will to power. When a group feels like they're losing, there is a deep and profound tendency to say this, by any means. Let me give you an example. How bad was Stalin? Okay, folks, I belong to a church where he killed 65 million people. My wife is named after Elizabeth Romanov, whose husband was blown up by Bolshevik terrorists and his body splattered across her dress. She then spent the rest of her working life dealing with the poor, spending her own money in the slums of Moscow. She was so saintly that when the Bolsheviks took over, many of the communists didn't want her killed. But Lenin rightly said, kill her first. They threw her down a mine shaft with her brothers, where peasants would come and they could hear her singing the hymns of Zion. When they pulled her body out of the mine shaft, they discovered that she had ripped her own nun's garments to bind the wounds of her brothers. Man, I know Stalin was bad. But in reaction to Lenin before Stalin and the horrible red terror that did what I just described, white Russians, not a racial thing, reds, whites, decided that nothing could be worse than the Bolsheviks. So we had to fight how? By any means. We'd have white Leninism. That's what they called it. And institute the white terror. And when we were done and took over, we'd take the tools that we used and drop them, and we could be trusted to do that. First of all, it never works. You can out-terror the Bolsheviks. Second of all, it corrupts the people who hold the tools so that by the time Kolchak and Rangel and Denikin and the white leaders were done with the white terror, they were as corrupt and useless as the Bolsheviks they were fighting. That's the temptation. The temptation when you're losing is to say what? By any means. Let me ask you a question. If you could take away your children's free will by raising them in a particular way so that they would have to become Christians, would you do it? If God put two people in a garden and left a tree there and let them choose, you should pause and think about it. By any means, I will not make my children Christian. It wouldn't work anyway. Yes?
So I get what you're saying about will to power. And I'm trying to make sense of what you're prescribing as far as the middle muddling through, because it sounds like you were saying that the ideal there is being...
I hate abortion, but I won't do anything to stop it. I will do anything. I will do anything I can do that's moral to stop it, but I won't do anything to stop it. Do you see the difference?
Sure, yes. The question I have is, it sounded like when you talked about muddling through in the middle, it sounded like the virtue there was not having an ideology, because the other two were ideologies to the extreme. Yes. But it seems like if the muddling through middle doesn't have an ideology, how are they to be guided on how to muddle through and how to avoid?
Yeah, no, that's exactly right. Here's the problem. We have to have both kinds of people in our communities and churches. What did I say? We need anchor people whose primary calling is to value what? What has been. And the old ways. And we need people in our church whose probably main spiritual gifting is towards change and might not have enough, they're change agents. And then the rest of us hopefully will be a blend of those two things. We'll see that appeal. And because neither group is exactly right or exactly wrong. And if we help them balance, both can be exactly right and exactly wrong. But the goal of being exactly right will generally produce awful results. Does this make sense at all? I'm not saying we should hope to be wrong. What I'm saying is that too often in practical affairs, we're not talking about theology where I hope to be exactly right, but to make our church perfectly holy. Can you imagine going for that? Not having some like realization that, okay, yes, that's the goal, but you know, I'm in the church. And somehow doing that without justifying my sin. Is sin ever good? No, down with sin. As my grandfather once said, what did you preach on? Sin. What was your position? I'm against it. This is the old country joke, and he actually used it. We're against sin, but we also understand that if we bear down too hard on humans, we might ourselves become ugly. Yet, the kind of person who says what I just said is often too light on sin. So what do? We walk humbly before God, neither in excess nor in defect, knowing that some people in our church are called to be the, let's do it for Jesus, through the breach. And some people are called to do what? Well, wait a minute. Not too quickly. And we listen to whom? Both. One more question. I realize it's a little practical compared to philosophy. Yeah.
Sure. As members of that Christian subculture, how can we speak into that or be effective in speaking into that in promoting that progressive conservatism?
Or
that,
conservative progressivism.
However we would like to say.
I am by instinct a I love the old ways guy. As I read the King James Bible for fun. My tendency is, if I'm not careful, to glorify the past. That's my tendency. So I always have to remind myself, there is no golden age. It was never awesome. We're not going back to the Garden of Eden, are we? We're going forward to the city of God. If you don't like living in an urban area, good luck to you. Right? We're going forward to the city of God, not our own private Idaho in a compound. So how do we do this? How do we do this? I don't know. Because if I would tell you, it would be inconsistent to my own talk. Fear above all people, C.S. Lewis, if you would hear, would say, the person who gives you the problem, generally the first three quarters of the book, which nobody disagrees with, and then what's the dangerous part of the book? The solution. I guess what I'm telling you is Jesus is Lord, the Bible is true, Christianity is true, you can know it to be true. We should be thoughtful and intellectually aware. We should also be spiritually alive. We should be holy, but not jerks about it. I'm just telling you, do what your grandmother always told you to do, or at least my grandmother always told me to do, lived out in 2016. Unchanging values change time. If I knew how to do that, I wouldn't write the book. It'd be too dangerous. So the answer to your question is, look at this room. You want to have hope for the future? I told you, it's a really depressing talk. I'll end on this note. You are the hope for the future. I know it's depressing. Don't, too much of that. Not the speakers, but look around. It's Saturday, and where are you? At a college and seminary, thinking about cultural trends, thinking, I hope, a little bit about Russia in 1913 and how it could go bad, thinking about the tension between excess and defect, how to muddle through, and you're going to bring that back to your churches, but you're not going to be ideological about it. You're the solution. That you're here means we're not doomed. Do you see that? You couldn't have put a group together like this in Russia in 1914 to save your life. In this room, you'll have people who voted for different people, I'll guarantee you, for president, or didn't vote at all. You'll have people who have different views on different theological issues, but you're all working together in a community of shared values, and you're not, if you're putting up with a talk like this, you're not ideologues. You'll listen to someone like Professor Shermer, who says things you don't agree with, or John Mark, who goes to a church you don't agree with and says things you're not sure are true, and you'll think about them and meditate on them, and like the Bereans, you'll look at Scripture, and you'll take what's scriptural, and you'll leave the rest behind. That's what you need to do. That's the solution. You're it. If not you, then whom? You love Jesus enough to be here, and you love thinking enough to listen. And you love truth enough to ask challenging questions or roll your eyes or think, oh, that's overstated, or I don't like that. Man, thank God. I wouldn't start a movement for a dollar. People often ask why I don't travel more and speak more. Because that's the last thing we need. I'll come talk to you and do things every once in a while, but mostly I need to be home. Building a K through college school that gets rid of student debt and helps kids in inner city Houston break free of poverty while simultaneously believing the Bible's the inerrant word of God and not changing on the social moral issues that are so unpopular in the center of Houston. Man, that's enough work for me. Isn't it for you? And anybody sounds smart until they're at home. Because my staff has to listen to me every day. If you think you're tired of me and I need to conclude now, I'm 5 minutes over, you should listen to them after a meeting. Go be the hope of the world. I believe with all my heart, you homeschool moms, Christian school teachers, and schools like this are the hope of the evangelical world in the United States. But it means we're going to have to change while not changing. Thank you. God bless you.